Since I had the pictures, I haven't deleted them yet, and I've been meaning to make this video for about 2 years now. We have three copies of the same exact lens. The one on the left is a rental from Lens Rentals. The other two are purchased brand new, in the box and everything, brand new. It is an over $2,000 lens. It is not a Nikon, and it is not an Otus. So the focus point was this little thing over here, and I chose it on purpose because it was small and it had high contrast. And I took breaks when I was focusing every time that I was uncertain, although I used maximum magnification and a loop. And as you can see here, the lens on the right is not very sharp at the focus point. So let's see items in the distance. Now over here we have the one on the left being the least sharp, the rental copy. I have to say here that the rental copy had a filter. The filter, as I remember, was very clean and very good quality, very reputable. But it produced probably the filter, I would say, this really ugly result. So lesson number one, all copies are not identical, even at $2,000 lenses. Lesson number two, check with filter and without filter, especially items in the distance, small details in the distance. Let's go, this is at 1.4, let's go to 1.8. So here we have 1.8. The images were taken within minutes from each other, but it was windy, so that's why you see the clouds being different. And here we have again the right copy, which I refocused, you know, as best as I could. And nobody can tell me you cannot focus a lens, but how do I focus the other two? All right. These two, the rental copy and this one in the middle, they look identical. Well, almost identical for items up close. Items far away, look at still the difference. And I strongly suspect this is a result over here of the filter. This is the strongest possibility. This is a 1.8. And as I said again, very clean, excellent quality filter. And I'm going to go directly to F4. At F4 now, we do not see, we see that even the right one is now sharp, in the little item over here. The right one, obviously, is a defective copy. Brand new, but defective. More than $2,000 lens, brand new. Not hit or anything, there are no signs like that. And items in the distance, you see that the right copy, although up close it's its problem, at a distance performs just fine. It's basically the rental copy on the left over here that is probably getting screwed by its own filter. Excellent quality, clean filter, no dust, no scratches, nothing. I inspected it thoroughly. But still, look at this. So then I took the rental out of the game and I only compared the middle copy, which is on the left, with our problematic copy on the right. And this time, in a more controlled environment, so to speak, and items that are closer. So to make sure that there is not much variation here, but there's still some difference in the contrast. As you can see, the lens on the left has better contrast. The lens on the right at 1.4, it looks kind of a little dull, a little more hazy, so to speak. At 1.8, we have The difference is a little less here, as it would be the normal thing. Let's check the bokeh. The bokeh looks identical pretty much. Some details in the bokeh may look a little different, but you cannot really tell the difference, right? Neither can I. And this is a F4, where we now have practically no difference in the middle. Still, the left one looks a little better in contrast, and as far as differences in the bokeh, nothing to talk about. Again, these were not of a Nikon lens, these copies, and were not the autos. But at any rate, users are pre-biased depending on the money they spend or the mythical reputation of the company. Sometimes you hear stories about Leica, for example, right? But Leica has had its problems too, to the point, as a matter of fact, that Lloyd Chambers at some point said that the quality control over there was poor, because he had a lot of copies that were not up to standards. Most users are not going to notice that, because they're not going to run detailed tests, and they're not going to do comparison tests, right? So this user over here, for example, says legendary Leica quality is not what it once was. Of the 6M lenses I have owned, 4 have had problems. These range from misaligned component parts to loose aperture rings, and in 2 cases, totally unacceptable performance wide open. This is not something that most users are going to notice. They're going to think that the performance is okay. They're wide open, they must be soft, and this and that. And this is a misconception generally. Theoretically speaking, even a lens that is cheap, let's say, and you expect it to be soft, wide open, and what have you, should be perfectly sharp at one theoretical point where the lens is actually focused. This performance here of the lens on the right at 1.8, and this is a 1.4 $2,000 lens, this performance is unacceptable. And the thing is that most users will never know. They will never know because the target is too small to begin with. It's very tiny. And they will actually assume that, okay, well, this is how it's supposed to render. They will assume that. Maybe because the lens is pushed into the market as an artistic rendering lens. And people are under the impression that artistic lenses must be blurry somehow. As far as the rental one on the left, which I believe is being screwed by its filter, because up close on the small target is sharp, but as you get further away, it gets really wacky. And still, most users who are using the lens with that particular filter are going to think that this is normal here on the left, because they do not have other copies of the same lens to compare it to. They're going to assume that this is normal, and to get it sharp, they have to close down an F16 or something. This is an error that users make, because blurriness on the focus point is frequently attributed to artistic characteristics. This is not correct. Every lens should be perfectly sharp at the focus point. Even with lenses that are designed to be soft focus does not mean that it's blurry. So my point is that if you're buying an expensive lens for critical applications, and even if the applications are not critical, but you bought a lens at a high price, compare it at least against a rental copy and remove the filter from the rental copy for the test. And if you are using filters, test your lens with and without the filter. Different filters have different properties, and this will become evident not at the focus point, which you see here, this is the focus point and it's perfectly sharp, even at 300%, but it will become very evident in distant objects that have complex structures, such as power poles. And if you notice, actually, the filter that is used here on the rental lens has even robbed a little bit of the color vibrancy and contrast. Overall, it has added some haziness to the scene, which will not be evident at the focus point, at the exact focus point, especially if the focus point is close. So do yourself a favor, even if you're using a wide angle lens, as in this case, and shoot a generic scene, like a landscape scene of some sort, with multiple items that you can compare each item. Because unfortunately, if you read blogs written by professionals whom I respect, they will tell you, put the target at 50 or 60 times the focal length of the lens. And this is the classic distance of a full body portrait, 50 or 60 times the focal length. However, at that distance, even if you notice differences, you're going to probably attribute the differences to, let's say, I must have misfocused, or the light was different. And we saw from the previous example that our copy on the right is very problematic. But here, it doesn't appear as problematic from this distance. Now you'll say, are you crazy? You're asking me to pay $2,000 for a brand new very reputable lens and having to pay another $85 for a rental copy to test against my lens. I am saying that, but you can do it with your 24-70 as well, at 2.8, which is going to be your 24-70, because even a mediocre 24-70 at 2.8, okay, maybe it's not going to cover the entire planar field perfectly sharp, but the precise point of focus must be sharp. At least one point must be sharp. And the difference may not be as noticeable, the problematic copies on the right, but if you're photographing autumn leaves, let's say, and you want a particular cluster of leaves that is very attractive, you want to print a big copy, and you see that the result is not as sharp, and then you say, oh, I gotta move to medium format then. Well, in reality, your problem was not the sensor, it was the lens. And maybe it was not the company, maybe the lens was damaged during transportation, it happens. The only species of lenses that according to users have no variation between the copies are the Otus line. However, remember what I said in 2018, it looked a little worn, but not that much. My problem is this hole here. It is not as bad as it looks in the picture, but it still will attract dust. I mean, if dust... It does attract dust. I mean, dust gets in. And it's not like I'm using in dusty environments. In our forests and stuff in the area, they're moist. They have no dust. And at home, it stays in a sealed, dry cabinet. It's still got dust inside, and I strongly suspect that this is the problem over here, the recessed focusing ring. Dust gets in from there as you focus the lens in and out. So no lens is perfect, but at least from anyone who has reported things about this lens is that there is no copy variation in the Otus line, and you pay for that. Though the jury is still out on that one, because paying more money is not always a guarantee. The knee-jerk reaction of users of any equipment, including computers, even fishing equipment, is that they find a defective copy of something. So what they do, they immediately go into the more expensive line, thinking that I'm gonna throw money on the problem, it's gonna solve itself. Then they get into a whole new array of problems all of a sudden, such as the case of Lloyd Chambers and many of his readers who reported the same problem with autofocusing accuracy of the GFX100S for landscapes. They find it completely unreliable. And although it's his camera of choice, you have the funny phenomenon of focusing the camera manually with maximum magnification to get perfect focus, and then you press the autofocusing button and it defocuses, moves away. And the readers are describing the same problem. And it was like that from the beginning. And then he also talks about the problem that I have talked to in the past in two or three different videos, that basically you get very small in pixels, you get diffraction. So you're losing the benefit and you get uncontrollable depth of field in this instance. So you need either to focus stack or go to a bigger sensor. But that's a different topic. And I finally found this old video, which was very revealing, and not many people paid attention to it. Let's hear a few things. After camera here, it's not the camera, but you're gonna see it's not due to the camera. This is the 50mm 1.8G. This is the 85 1.4G. This is the Zeiss 135 APOS Owner, and this is the Nikon 70-200 F4. I will concentrate on the 85 1.4G, and you can see here a double color text, which you do not see with the Zeiss, you do not see with the other two Nikons. Double color text, and this result was confirmed by taking the same picture on two different days, one with harsh light and the other with relatively soft light. Under soft light, the effect was a little lower. Later on, I tested the theory again with another copy of the 85 1.4G, and the result was the same, double color text. I still consider it the first best or second best portrait lens for Nikon F. But if you're gonna shoot landscapes, you gotta be aware of that. I'm never gonna get subscribers with this kind of content. At any rate, Milorad is asking, what is your opinion on black and white photos? You remove the color, meaning you're removing the distraction of the color. You're basically making a sketch now, so you're asking the viewer to pay attention to the subject. My daughter took this picture at the port of my city in Crete 3 years ago. So what do you see? You see a couple of boats up front, you see the sea, the sky, the city on the right side. That's what attracts your attention, right? What do you see now? You see the boats in the middle that you didn't notice before, these ones. In the original, that's not the first thing that attracts your attention, because the illumination is even in these boats and the color is the same. So your eye will fall on the ones that are on the lower right side and the city in the back. And then you look at the sea and a little bit of the sky and you move forward. But over here now, you got higher contrast and you got specific lines, and those lines over here and these lines over here is what attracts your attention as well, even more than other parts of the image. Sometimes the subject is obvious, but you want to change the storyline. So here you have two girls chit-chatting and laughing, watching the sundown next to a nicely paved road. That's the emotion of the scene. And here you have two girls sharing a story and contemplating on their feelings. There are many very good videos on the topic on YouTube. An excellent one is the Seeing in Black and White with Eileen Rafferty by B&H Photo Videos. This channel has some really good videos. What's the best way to do it? Let's stick with these pictures my daughter took from Greece. With a little Panasonic Micro Four Thirds, beautiful camera, beautiful, sharp, everything. My advice is stick with one profile, one preset. Okay, one profile. Because this way you will learn how to manipulate the sliders very fast. You can become an expert really fast if you're working with one profile all the time. Okay, you will know what to do. If you work with many different profiles and you try this preset and the other preset, and you're gonna get lost very easily. So that's my advice on how to do it properly. But there is also another option, the desaturated color image that kind of looks like black and white, but it's not. And it is naturally this way because you shot it against the light, let's say. On the balance, these kind of images can be a lot more rewarding. Thanks a lot. Bye.